A very warm welcome, dear children. We are back again to the class of biology, and today we will be discussing about the mechanism of breathing, right? So we will talk about how breathing takes place inside our body, right? So the mechanism of breathing. And just before we start with the mechanism of breathing, let's quickly go through the structure of the alveoli, right? Very important to understand before we talk about what happens during breathing, right? So actually what takes place inside the lungs. So just before we know, we learn, we study what happens inside the lungs, we will quickly go through the structure of the alveoli. Now, since another term used for lungs are pulmones, right? Pulmones are is a term that is used for lungs, right? So anything or any term in which the word pulmonary is there is related to lungs, right? So pulmonary alveoli means the alveoli which is found inside the lungs. So what are alveoli? They are the unit, the basic unit of lungs, right? The basic unit of lungs, that is what the lungs the lung is made up of. So the alveolar ducts, what are the ducts? Ducts are small tubes, right, which are connected to the alveolus, right? So the singular is alveolus, otherwise the plural word is alveoli, right? So the alveolar ducts, they open into the pulmonary alveoli, right? So this is the pulmonary alveoli and this is the duct which opens into the pulmonary alveoli. Alveolar sacs. So if you look at this structure here, this whole bunch is known as the alveolar sac. So what are alveolar sacs? These are clusters of pulmonary alveoli. So like for example, if this is one alveolar sac, inside this there are many alveoli that are present, right? So this whole structure is the alveolar sac, which is a cluster of pulmonary alveoli. So the alveolar ducts, the pulmonary alveoli and the alveolar sacs, right? The alveolar duct, the pulmonary alveoli and the alveolar sac, this makes up the respiratory division of the lungs, right? So inside the lungs there are many of these that are present, so that makes up the respiratory division of the lungs. And gas exchange, right? Gas exchange. Now when we talk about the gas exchange, then what happens is oxygen enters, right, and carbon dioxide is removed, right? This is the exchange that takes place, right? So exchange of gas occurs across the walls of the tiny pulmonary alveoli. Now if we look at the walls of the tiny pulmonary alveoli, the structure here, this is the alveolus. The walls are very very thin, right? So exchange of gas occurs across the walls, and then you can see here the capillary that is shown over here, right? So these minute expansions, what are these minute expansions? The tiny pulmonary alveoli, the many that are present inside, they are the functional units of the respiratory system, and they are huge in number. They are around 350 millions of alveoli that are present in each lung. Per lung means each lung, right? So the left lung may have these many alveoli, the right lung may have these many alveoli. And so if there are so many, 350 millions, and if you spread it all around, you will understand how much of area these alveoli cover, right? In the previous class we've already discussed that, and that is the great area that is present for the diffusion of gases, right? So what do these alveoli do is they increase the they increase the surface area for diffusion of gases. So they increase the surface area for diffusion of gases. So that is what they do. The diffusion rate is rather increased, right? Now the diffusion rate, how fast or how slow it is increased by the fact that the wall of each pulmonary alveolus is only another additional advantage for diffusion is that the wall of each alveolus is very, very thin, right? So how thin is it? It is just one cell layer thick. One cell, you know how cells, how thick the cells are? One cell layer thick, right? Only one cell layer thick. So we know that cells already are microscopic. So how thick that one cell would be, one cell layer, right? So the total air blood barrier, right? The total air and blood barrier, right? This is the barrier, right? Between the air and the blood. So the total air blood barrier is only one pulmonary alveolar cell with its basement membrane, blood capillary cell across, which is about 2 micrometers. So the walls of the alveoli are made up of two types of cells, right? So the cells, they permit diffusion and they secrete a substance called surfactant that reduces the tendency of the pulmonary alveoli to collapse, right? So those are the two types of cells that make up the alveoli. You can see how the blood capillaries, they surround each alveolus, right? So that is here, you can see the structure. The alveolar duct is there, the alveolar sac is there, the pulmonary alveoli you can see, right? So these are, that is the structure of the alveoli. And we will also quickly do the structure of the lungs, right? So we will just quickly go through this also. So that is the human lungs, right? Large, they are large. Large. Second is they are spongy. So they are large and they are spongy and they are paired also. You can see there is a left and a right lung. So they are paired also. Paired organs within the thoracic cavity. What is the thoracic cavity? Thoracic is the chest region. What region is the thoracic region? That is the chest region, right? So within the thoracic cavity. So yes, so the lungs are within the thoracic cavity. Each lung from the diaphragm, here is the diaphragm. So each lung from the diaphragm to a point just above the clavicle, and its surfaces are bordered by the ribs to the front and back. So from here, that is the clavicle region, right? So ribs are present, right? Front and back again, right? So that is the rib cage, right? The lungs are separated from one another by heart. So you can see here, this is the region of the cardiac notch, right? So here you can see the heart that is located. So the heart is one thing that is separating the two lungs, right? And the other structures of the mediastinum, which is the area between the lungs. So this is the area between the lungs, right? So all the structures that are present in between the lungs, that is separating the two lungs, the left and the right lung. All the structures of the respiratory system beyond the principal bronchi, that is the main bronchi, including the bronchial tree and the pulmonary alveoli. This is the main bronchi, right? You can see here, these are the main bronchi, pulmonary bronchi, right? Other than that, all the parts here which are entering inside the lungs, they are contained inside the lung basically, right? Now let's come to the left and the right lung, right? So you can see here, this is the left lung, this is the right lung. They are basically similar, but they are not identical, right? They are similar but not identical. Now why? If you look at the left lung is somewhat smaller, right? If we will see the size, we will see that the left lung is somewhat smaller as compared to the right lung, right? Again, we see that it has a depression over here, right, which is known as the cardiac notch. This depression is for the heart to fit inside, right? So the heart occupies space here, so that is the depression. The left lung is subdivided. You can see the left lung is internally it is divided into a superior lobe. Here you can see, I'll just erase this. You can see here, this part is the superior lobe, right? Into the superior lobe and an inferior lobe, right? So this lower part is the inferior lobe, right? And it is this division is done by just a single fissure. So this is the fissure, right? Coming to the right lung, it is subdivided by two fissures, right? So you can see here, this part here is the superior lung. Then you can see here the middle part, this is the median middle lobe, and then the inferior lobe. So they're divided into three lobules, right? And each lobe of the lung is divided into many small lobules, right? So even this, if we talk about, they are divided into still smaller lobules, right, which in turn contains the pulmonary alveoli. Now each lobule will contain many pulmonary alveoli, right? Now each lung, right, whether it is the left lung or it is the right lung, let's say here, each lung is surrounded by a double layered membrane, right? Double layered membrane, one more thin membrane is there. So that's the double layered membrane that is present, right? This membrane is known as the pleura or the pleural membrane, right? So that is the pleura or the pleural membrane, right? It adheres or it is attached to the outer surface of the lung, right? This is found on the outer surface, not inside, outer surface of the lung. The inner layer, that means this layer, there are two layers, you can see, this is the outer layer and this is the inner layer, right? Now there are names given to both the layers, right? The inner layer is called the visceral layer. So the inner layer is known as the visceral layer, right? Inner layer is the visceral layer and the outer layer is known as the parietal layer, right? So the inner layer is the visceral layer. It adheres to the outer surface of the lung. It is closely, see, this is the inner layer, which is known as the visceral layer. It is attached very closely to the outer surface of the lung, right? Then we come to the outer layer. The outer layer is called the parietal layer. It lines the thoracic walls. Now see, outer layer, this is the outer layer, right? This is, the lung is found in the thoracic region. So it is attached to the thoracic wall, surface of the diaphragm. Thoracic walls and the thoracic surface of the diaphragm. See, lower down is the diaphragm. So it is attached on one side to the diaphragm and on the other side it is attached to the thoracic walls. Now there is space in between these two layers. This space is filled with a fluid, a lubricating fluid, right? This space is known as the pleural cavity, right? Space is a cavity, that is this pleural cavity. This is filled with a lubricating fluid, which is known as the pleural fluid. What is the function of this fluid? That it allows the membranes to slide past each other easily during respiration, right? And any inflammation in the pleura leads to a disease that is known as pleurisy, right? So that's about the lungs. And now we move on to the mechanism of breathing, right? The mechanism of breathing, or how does breathing take place? Now, if we talk about the mechanism of breathing, right, there are many steps that are involved in the process of respiration in humans, right? So let's quickly understand what are the steps that are involved. Number one, the first step is breathing, right? So breathing is one step. What is breathing? Letting in fresh air, that is oxygen, into the lungs, and foul air out of the lungs. Foul air is rich in carbon dioxide. The second step that takes place is exchange of gases on the alveolar surface, right? On the alveolar surface. Third step that takes place is transport and exchange of gases, right? Transport and exchange of gases. This is the third phase. And the fourth is internal. Once this is taken place, then the fourth step is internal respiration. Right, so the fourth is internal respiration. Now coming to breathing, what is breathing? It is simply the process of taking fresh air, right? There is no chemical reaction that takes place in breathing. So what is breathing? It is the process of taking in fresh air, right? Taking in fresh air from the atmosphere into the lungs, right? Where do we take in fresh air? We take in fresh air from the atmosphere. Where does it go? It enters into the lungs, right? Another step of breathing is expelling, giving out the foul air from the lungs, right? The chemical reactions that take place inside the lungs, as a result of which, we've just studied cellular respiration, as a result of which carbon dioxide is formed. Carbon dioxide cannot be used up in the body, so it has to be removed because it is a waste gas, right? So the coming out or the expelling out of the foul air from the lungs to the outside of the body, right, that is to the exterior, is known as breathing. So breathing includes both. Number one, taking in oxygen or air rich in oxygen. Number two is expelling out air that is rich in carbon dioxide. So air that is rich in oxygen is known as fresh air. Air that is rich in carbon dioxide is known as foul air, right? So this is what is breathing. And this breathing as I told you just now, it is not a chemical process. It is a simple mechanical process, and it is completed in two distinct steps, right? There are two steps that are involved in breathing. What are these two steps? Number one is inspiration, right? Inspiration. What is inspiration? Inhaling or taking in of fresh air or atmospheric air into the lungs. What is inspiration? Inhalation, right? Inhalation or taking in of fresh air into the lungs. Fresh air is air from the atmosphere, right? This is an active process, right? We will just now discuss what is an active process and what is a passive process, right? The second step that is involved is expiration. The second step involved is expiration in breathing, right? What is expiration? It is expelling. Throwing out, right? Expelling or throwing out of what? Foul air. What is foul air? Air that is rich in carbon dioxide is foul air, right? So from where is it expelled? From the lungs to the outside of the body or to the exterior of the body. And this process is a passive process, right? So inspiration is an active process and expiration is a passive process, right? Okay, now let's talk about the lungs. We know that lungs are in direct contact with the atmosphere. How? Right, see, we are talking about the lungs. These are the lungs here. That is what it is showing. It is in direct contact with the atmosphere. How? Through the respiratory tract. Right, this is the respiratory tract. Air from the atmosphere enters into the respiratory tract and directly the atmospheric air enters the lungs. So, the lungs are in direct contact with the atmosphere through the respiratory tract. Since lungs have little musculature means hardly any muscles are there in the lungs, right? So, little musculature, they cannot expand or they cannot contract on their own, right? Very important thing about the lungs, right? Lungs have little musculature. Little musculature means less muscles. So, if they do not have much muscles, so they cannot contract, or relax on their own, right? So, they cannot expand or contract on their own. But this has to take place. So, the movement of air in and out of the lungs occurs due to alternate changes in the intrapulmonary pressure. Now, this is brought about by inspiration as well as expiration, by contraction and relaxation of the diaphragm. So, what are the things involved? Number one, diaphragm. Diaphragm is involved, right? There is a specialized set of muscles which are known as the intercostal muscles. Right, intercostal muscles. Muscles are always found in pairs, antagonistic in nature. So, there are external intercostal muscles and internal intercostal muscles. Now, where are these muscles present? These muscles are present in between the ribs. If you look at the diagram, you can see these muscles shown in red, external intercostal muscles. Right, in between the ribs, these intercostal muscles are present, and similarly, the internal intercostal muscles are also found in between the ribs. Right, so the external intercostals, they slant forward and downward, while the internal intercostal muscles, they slant backward and downward. Right, so that's about what is involved. Now, if we talk about inspiration, the overall size of the thoracic cavity. Now, what happens during inspiration? Right? Now, we move on to this particular figure which is showing inspiration. Right? So, here if you look, the overall, now what happens during inspiration is that the overall size of the thoracic cavity increases. What is the thoracic cavity? This region here is the thoracic cavity. What happens to the thoracic cavity? The size of the thoracic cavity would increase, right? When does it increase? It increases at the time of inspiration, right? During relaxed inspiration, the muscles of importance, what are the muscles that play role during inspiration, are the diaphragm, right? Diaphragm. Very important to know what are the muscles that play role during inspiration and what are the muscles that play role during expiration. So, during inspiration, the muscles of importance are the diaphragm and the external intercostal muscles, right? These are the muscles that play role. Now, what happens is contraction of the dome shaped diaphragm. If you look at the diaphragm is dome shaped. What is dome shaped? Here you can see just below the lungs. This is the position of the diaphragm. Right? Now, during inspiration, what will happen? The diaphragm will contract. So, when it will contract, the diaphragm will move down and it will flatten. So, the moment the diaphragm moves down, you will see vertically the space in the thoracic cavity would increase, right? So the movement of the diaphragm downwards, that means when it contracts, increases the vertical height. If you look at the figure and see the height, now this is the dome shaped part, the height of the thoracic cavity is only this much. Once it flattens, it contracts, the height further increases to this area, right? So contraction of the dome shaped diaphragm causes it to flatten, that means the diaphragm flattens, and this leads to the increase in the vertical height of the thoracic cavity. At the same time, simultaneously, the external intercostal muscles, here you can see the external intercostal muscles are labeled here, right? They contract, and the internal intercostal muscles, they relax. So as I told you that the muscles are found in pairs and they are antagonistic in nature, right? So it increases the diameter. Now once this contracts, the diameter this way increases, right? So volume itself increases. Now due to their combined action, see, combined action this way also the size has increased, and sideways also the size has increased, right? Now due to the combined action, the volume of the thoracic cavity increases. Here you see, this is the volume of the thoracic cavity here, this is increased. Earlier it would be just this much, right? And at the time of inspiration, it increases this much. And the air pressure within the pleural cavities, they fall below. You know what is the pleural cavity, the space between the two, right? So that falls below that of the atmosphere. Now this causes the lungs to inflate due to inward movement, right? Immediately the air moves inside, and the lungs inflate like how the balloons inflate when you blow air into the balloon, right? Now the next stage is expiration, right? This was inspiration. Next is expiration, where we expel out the foul air. Now as I told you earlier, this is a passive process, right? This is a passive process. The muscles of the diaphragm, now the muscle, earlier the diaphragm was somewhere here at the time of inspiration, and now the muscles of the diaphragm relax. So when they relax, they move back, this is the relaxed rate, they move back to the original dome shaped structure, right? The internal intercostal muscles, they contract. So what, when they contract, they will pull the ribs inward and downward. And when the internal intercostal muscles contract, the external intercostal muscles, they relax. Due to this combined action of the diaphragm, earlier the thoracic cavity was this much, now it becomes this much, right? So if you see, the diaphragm will push and this will move in, right? So obviously what is happening, the space is becoming less in the thoracic cavity, right? Now this leads to removal of the, or expelling of the air. Due to this combined action of the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles, the rib cage, you know, it will come back to its original position. Now this leads to decrease in the volume of the thoracic cavity, leading to increased pressure within the pleural cavities, and this causes the lungs to deflate due to outward movement of air. The air moves out, right? So that is simply what is expiration. And inspiration, which is a mechanical process, a part of respiration, right? A physical process, a physical part of respiration, and a very important part of respiration, because it is through this only that the air enters the lungs. Now we move to the next part, the respiratory volumes and capacities, right? So here is a table that is there given for the respiratory volumes and capacities. Now the amount of air breathed in a given time is an important indicator of a person's respiratory status, right? So how strong is our respiratory status? How strong are our lungs? Right. The air that we breathe, the amount of air that we breathe in at a given time tells us how strong our lungs are. Right. So the amount of air exchanged during pulmonary ventilation varies from exchange of air, oxygen and carbon dioxide. Now this varies from person to person, right? Age also plays a role, gender, whether male or female, the activity level plays a role, general health, if somebody is always sick or weak, that also, you know, will show a different the strength of the lungs would be different, right? And then there are individual differences. So the respiratory volumes are measured by an instrument which is called the spirometer. I'm enlarging this. Yeah, this is a spirometer, right? The structure, you can see the spirometer where you can see how it is checked through this instrument. Respiratory strength is checked through this instrument, spirometer, right? Now, talking about the respiratory volumes, the normal adult respiratory volumes and capacities, they are represented here in the table, right? Number one is these are measured directly with the help of spirometer, right? So this is in a normal adult, what is the average volume? So the tidal volume, these are very important because these are asked in the exams also. Tidal volume, it is the volume of air inspired or expired during a normal respiration, right? Normally when we respire every time, that is what is the tidal volume, right? Approximately it is 500 ml. Next is the inspiratory reserve volume, right? The inspiratory reserve volume is the extra volume of air that can be inhaled above the tidal. What extra air can we inhale above what normally we have inhaled? Right, so volume by maximum forced inspiration. After normal inspiration, if we can force in some more air, that is inspiratory reserve, which is about 2500 ml to 3000 ml. Then comes the expiratory reserve volume. It is the extra volume of air that can be forcibly exhaled. Normally when we exhale air, and forcibly, how much more air can be exhaled, right, after normal inspiration. It is about 1000 to 1100 ml. Then comes the residual volume. Volume of air remaining, residue, leftover. So volume of the air remaining in the lungs even after maximum forced. Even maximum after you force out the air from your lungs, what still there is some air that is left inside the lung. That leftover air is the residual volume, which may be around 1100 ml to 1200 ml. Coming to the next part is the respiratory capacities, right? They are calculated by adding up some of the respiratory volumes which have been described just now earlier. These are used for clinical diagnosis, right? So the first one is inspiratory capacity, that is the total volume of air a person can inspire after a normal expiration. It is sum total of tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume, right? So IC, we can say inspiratory capacity. Tidal volume, how much we discussed just now, is 500 ml, right, plus 3000 ml as discussed just now, right? So that makes it to 3500 ml. Next is the expiratory capacity. This is the total volume of air a person can expire after a normal inspiration. So it is the sum total of tidal. So if I write here, tidal is 500 ml plus expiratory reserve volume, which is 1100 ml, right? So this comes to 1600 ml. Third is the functional residual capacity, right? The functional residual capacity, it is the volume of air that remains in the lungs after a normal expiration. So what volume of air remains in the lungs after normal expiration is 1100 ml, right, plus It is a sum total of expiratory reserve volume and the residual volume. So expiratory reserve volume is 1100 ml and the residual volume is 1200 ml, so that makes it to 2300 ml. Then comes the vital capacity. What is vital capacity? It is the maximum volume of air a person can breathe in after a forced expiration. So what would that be? It would be a sum total of expiratory reserve. Expiratory reserve is 1100 ml, right, plus inspiratory reserve, which is 3000 ml, and the tidal volume, which is 500 ml. So that comes to a total of 4600 ml. Then comes the total lung capacity. Total lung capacity is the volume of total volume of air contained in the lungs at the end of a maximum forced inspiration, right? So after you inspire and you take in forced air, what is the total volume of air that is there at that time, right? So it would be the it would be a sum total of the residual volume. Residual volume would be RV, right, plus expiratory reserve volume, right, plus the inspiratory reserve volume and the tidal volume. So sum total of everything, right? So that is the total lung capacity. Then comes the last thing, that is the dead space. So what is the dead space? The air contained in the respiratory passage, right? Respiratory passage is not only the lungs, right? This is called the dead space because it does not reach the alveoli and it is not used in gaseous exchange. So the dead space is always 150 ml, right? So that's the dead space that is present. You can just go through this graph that is shown, right? And we will end the class here. We will talk about the regulation of breathing in the next class.